PQQ, is this a dietary supplement you should be taking? PQQ is the topic of today's video, and I want to give you an unbiased opinion on whether or not this is something you should add to your supplement regimen or not. I've looked at the research on PQQ, I've come to some conclusions, and I'm going to give you the high points of my investigation, which appears on my Supplement Clarity website. I'll link to that in the description so you can see the full review. But this is going to be a review mostly of the PQQ research. So what will you learn? Well, we'll talk about PQQ real fast, what it is, and also give you an idea of some foods that have it in case you want to get it from eating food. And I also want to delve into the research as it is today on the PQQ dietary supplement. So before we go any further, let's address the elephant in the room. How the heck do you pronounce PQQ? So I practiced this on my own, and I'm going to give it a shot right here. And here we go. PQQ stands for pyrroloquinoline quinone. There, I did it. Pyrroloquinoline quinone. And it is a compound that was originally considered to be a vitamin. Research has since shown it is not a vitamin. It's more vitamin-like. And it's touted to have a variety of different health benefits in the body. I want to touch on some of the more important ones and things you've probably heard of if you've been researching PQQ on your own. So foods with PQQ, these are some of the ones that I uncovered and their associated amounts. Fermented soy has some of the highest PQQ amounts at 61 nanograms per gram. It sounds like a lot, but we have to remember that a nanogram is a billionth of a gram. So if you were to eat 1 gram of fermented soy, you'd be getting about 61 billionths of a gram of PQQ. Obviously, supplements are going to have much higher levels of this. Usually, dietary supplements clock in at between 20 and 30 milligrams per capsule. But definitely, food is something you can get small amounts if that is something you want to be doing. So I want to delve into the research real fast and give you a quick lay of the land of what it looks like right now. Let's start with heart and cardiovascular health. All right. So here is a study from 2004. PQQ decreases myocardial infarct size and improves cardiac function in rat models. Stop right there. This is a rat. Basically, they're saying that PQQ helps the hearts of these rats work better. That's great. That's wonderful. But we're not a rat. We're a human. And yes, we may share some DNA with rats, but it's not 100% DNA. We are humans. We're much more complicated than rats. So right off the bat, when you're reading research, you should always be looking for human research and not lab animal research. But again, this is what was in this study. So let's see another investigation. So here's one from 2011, altering PQQ nutritional status modulates mitochondrial lipid and energy metabolism in, again, rats. Basically, they cut off the PQQ supply to these rats and noticed that they weren't as healthy. This is one of the reasons why people will say, we should be taking PQQ so that we can stay healthy. Okay, well, where's the evidence of that? In a rat, there does appear to be some evidence that it helps our mitochondria, but what about the people? Here's another investigation. Protective effect of PQQ in rat model of cerebral hemorrhage. Essentially, what they're saying here is that the PQQ protected the brains of the rats from a stroke, essentially. That does not necessarily mean that it protects human brains from strokes, but it is an interesting finding. What about brain health? Again, that last study was a rat study. It looked at brain health. But how about this one? Effects of antioxidant supplements on cerebral blood flow and oxygen metabolism in the prefrontal cortex. This was a human study. Involved 20 healthy people between the ages of 50 and 70 years of age. They were followed for 3 months and given a PQQ supplement called BioPQQ. And they noted that the PQQ supplement increased the oxygen supply to the brains of these individuals, basically increased the oxygen supply to the prefrontal cortex, and that's an important part of our brain, plays a role in our personality and critical thinking and stuff like that. So that's actually a more interesting study to me than the rat studies we talked about previously. What else we got? So if we look at reducing inflammation, that's always a good thing because higher levels of inflammation taken out over years can play a role in a variety of diseases. So if we can reduce the inflammation of the body, we might be able to reduce the risk of various chronic diseases. So here's an investigation. Again, a human study. Dietary PQQ alters indicators of inflammation and mitochondrial-related metabolism in human subjects. Smaller study, 10 people, 5 women, 5 men, and they gave them 2 different dosages of PQQ and noted that the supplement reduced C-reactive protein, CRP. This is a blood test marker of inflammation in the body. Some of you may have already had a CRP test. Doctors sometimes will even test for this one if you ask them to. They gave them 2 different dosages of PQQ. They gave them 0.2 milligrams per kilogram of body weight and 0.3 milligrams per kilogram of body weight. How much is that? Well, if you were to remember that a kilogram is 2.2 pounds, if you're in America watching this video, you would just take your body weight, divide it by 2.2, that'll give your weight in kilograms, and then multiply it times 0.2 and 0.3, and that'll give you your amount for your body weight. I calculated this on my website for a 180-pound person, and it came to between 16 milligrams and 25 milligrams. That's kind of in line with what I see with a lot of dietary supplements. Okay, so, but this is an interesting human study, which I'm glad to see. The human research on PQQ, I think, deserves more attention. The vast majority of research that I see involves rats, but here is a quick synopsis of the research that I uncovered when I did my PQQ review. This is, again, a summary of what we just talked about. Researchers gave a small number of people, 10 people, PQQ in a drink, and it reduced free radical damage, as they indicated, through a reduction in T-bars. That's a marker of free radical damage. And also, it also reduced inflammation through reducing CRP levels. Another study noted that PQQ improved blood flow to the prefrontal cortex. Okay, we already talked about that. And again, they used that supplement called BioPQQ. That appears to be the dietary supplement that has most of the clinical research on it, BioPQQ, if that helps anybody. Another investigation noted that a PQQ supplementation might reduce LDL, bad cholesterol, in human beings. Again, I would point out that when I looked at the data for this particular study, there was a reduction in LDL levels for these people, but the bad cholesterol was still considered high. So whether or not PQQ lowers bad cholesterol levels, I think needs a better investigation. And again, the study also noted no change in triglyceride levels. Last study I uncovered was that PQQ might help people sleep better. I don't know how great this study was because it lacked a placebo group, but they had people take PQQ and fill out surveys before and after the supplementation, and they noticed that they slept better, felt less anxious, etc. It's interesting, but I'd like to see one with a placebo group. That would make this study a lot more powerful. So do you need to be taking PQQ? And that's obviously a decision we each of us need to be making for ourselves. I want to see more human research, and I know more research will be going on in the future. And again, if you check back to my Supplement Clarity website, that's where I'm going to be chronicling all the human research as it becomes available. So guys, I hope this quick video helped you. Until next time, I'm Joe Cannon. Have yourself a fantastic day. Take care. Bye-bye.